I was born and brought up in New Zealand, where I was educated. I was lucky enough to have been brought up in the period when education in New Zealand was not only free but of extremely high quality, particularly primary and secondary education, with a great emphasis on skills such as reading and speaking, and I think they stood me in very good stead. We also had wonderful library service, which I was able to use, and my parents were very encouraging in terms of getting us kids to read, and I think that, as you can see, has very much coloured my professional life as well, both reading and writing. I was educated, I went to university in Australia and subsequently in the UK, in Reading, where I did an MA in TESOL. I currently live in Spain, in Barcelona, and have been living here for many years now. Prior to that, I worked for quite a while in the Middle East, primarily in Egypt, and that was an extremely influential period in my development as a teacher and as a teacher trainer. My current projects, well, I'm working at the moment on a piece for a collection of papers which Jane Arnold in Seville is editing, which are loosely connected to the notion of holistic or humanistic teaching. And my particular interest is in the notion of what's sometimes called embodied cognition or situated learning. The way that the mind, as it were, and the language-using mind extends beyond the narrow shed of the body and reaches out into the environment through gesture, principally. But also how this is reflected in the way that we use language and the way that we learn language. The idea that there is a kind of fluidity, if you like, between the mind and the environment, and we need to take this into account when we're teaching. So that's my current interest, and it is very interesting and extremely challenging too, because I'm moving outside of purely second language acquisition literature and looking at literature related to cognition in general. What motivates me? I suppose, I mean, with regard to that last topic, the notion of embodied cognition, it's kind of a curiosity that develops out of reading, out of talking to people, out of attending talks, out of watching classrooms, etc. These puzzles that are created by certain things that happen, which drives me back into the literature to see if I can find any explanations. So I think it's that kind of curiosity, and also the feedback that I get from people certainly motivates me when I'm doing workshops and talks. It's an enormous sense of encouragement, and the fact that people now take the trouble to respond to my blog, for example. So it's that kind of feedback loop which I think is extremely motivating, and it's much more accessible now than it used to be. In the days when you wrote a book, the book was published, it kind of disappeared into the world out there, and you never really got any feedback. Now you can get feedback on a daily basis, and that's extremely motivating. The important influences in my professional life, well, I guess it's the people I've worked with as a teacher trainer, particularly, and I think of people I've worked with here in Barcelona when I did worked on pre-service and in-service courses. That wonderful team of teacher trainers, and the conversations we had, both in the workplace and outside of the workplace, were extraordinarily important to me, and especially at that period when I was started writing articles and books, and they really sort of informed, those discussions really informed my whole thinking. So I think, without wanting to name individuals, it's that team that we created, that we worked and worked so energetically, and which is still working very energetically in International House Barcelona, just down the road. Okay, as to the question as whether education is working as it should, I'm not qualified to talk about all education, but certainly language education, I think, as part of all education, is very much driven now by the need for accountability and assessment. And I think this is having a very, very negative washback effect on teaching. That we now teach for the tests, and not only that, that the content of the curriculum is packaged in the way that it's easily testable. I mean, there's nothing new about this, but it just seems to have become very, very, very pervasive in the last few years. That you speak to a lot of teachers of English now, and what they're doing is simply preparing their students for IELTS, for Cambridge First Certificate, or whatever. And really, it's very difficult to think in terms of moving beyond that, or looking at how language is used in the real world beyond the tests. And if we look at how language is used in the real world, then I think, of course, that would have an impact on how we teach it. And I think that was the point of the communicative approach when it was developed in the 1970s and 80s, and which affected me enormously as a relatively inexperienced teacher, that suddenly language, the idea of context and authenticity became key criteria for assessing the worthfulness of a methodology. Not just whether you learnt by rote or could produce particular structural patterns, but whether you could function as a language user in the kind of context in which you were likely to encounter. And I think that was a very important motivator for the communicative approach. But I think we've kind of lost that. And I think a lot of what I try to do in my workshops and my writing is retrieve that kind of philosophy, if you like, that language learning and language use are situated, contextualized, social, and personalized, and that this should reflect on the way that we teach it. As to the question about technologies like blogging, tweeting, social networks. Yes, I think, I mean, I've taken advantage now of all those. I've got a Facebook account, I blog once a week, I tweet once a day, I mean, email, of course, I teach online. The whole way that the technology has allowed us not just to communicate with each other, but to build community. And I think this is, I talked before about the community of teacher trainers that we formed in International House Barcelona, which was so powerful as a formative influence on our professional lives. Now that community, of course, extends and it's dispersed. It's not nowhere near as concentrated necessarily, but it's still available to teachers all around the world. And I think, witness this little video, for example, on a blog site. So I think that has been extremely powerful, and I think it's a I'm so glad that I've been around to be able to take advantage of this. And finally, what is my next immediate goal? I think my next immediate goal is to make a cup of coffee. Thanks very much. It's been nice talking to you.